Gokongwei Group Chairman Lance Gokongwei sees a challenging second half of the year, but says he remains optimistic about overall economic growth. Gokongwei, whose holding company JG Summit managed to turn profitable in the first half with $10.4 billion in profit, says higher costs and rates will continue to weigh on business.
The second half will be challenging because of the delayed effects of higher interest rates. Also, we're seeing some inflationary pressures as oil prices are beginning to come back, maybe rice prices. It's really more normal economic growth and just people going back to what people do, which is they want to meet their family, they want to meet their friends, they want to go back to school, they want to go back to work.
Meanwhile, the Gokongwei Brothers Foundation reaffirmed its commitment to science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, or STEM education, and teachers during its 30th anniversary celebration. It says STEM is the driving force behind sustainable national development.
Our vision is really to support more STEM education in the countries. We believe science, technology, engineering, math are really fundamental for a country's growth. Help teachers really become achieve better teaching methodologies, have access to technology, have access to continuous learning.
We want to teach teachers, help them, enable them to do better their teaching skills.
Philippine Airlines looking to return to Europe by 2025 following its purchase of several jets. PAL President and COO Stanley Nang said they're exploring the best destinations in Europe, with Italy coming out as the top choice and a Manila to Brussels flight also on the table. The 2020 COVID-19 pandemic discontinued the flag carrier's direct flights to London as well as to several other countries. But now that tourism is recovering because of revenge travel, PAL has been making moves to rebuild its international routes, including the expansion of its current 81-jet fleet. During this year's Paris Air Show, the carrier inked an over 170 billion peso purchase deal for 9 Airbus A350-1000 aircraft, which will be used for long-haul services from Manila to the east coast of U.S. and Canada. The Philippine Central Bank extends its prudent pause as expected, keeping the benchmark policy rate at a 16-year high of 6.25%. But it signaled it's ready to tighten if necessary, acknowledging upside risks to inflation. Lady Vicencio reports.
The Monetary Board of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas kept its benchmark interest rate at 6.25% for a third consecutive meeting.
The basic story remains the same. We have declining inflation rates, and we expect to be within the target range in 2024 and 2025.
However, the BSP raised its inflation outlook for this year and the next, despite the consumer price index cooling for a sixth straight month in July. For 2023, Philippine inflation is now seen climbing to 5.6% from 5.5% due to the possible impact of transport prices and food supply constraints, which could be aggravated by El Nino. For 2024, the forecast was revised upwards to 3.3% from 2.8%. Both figures still well above government's 2-4% target.
Incorporated into our risk matrix, but not in the baseline forecast, but along with the baseline, we're looking at various scenarios. And even if we combine that with some other risk factors, it's not enough to cause us a breach of the inflation target in 2024. Of course, it still is a factor of the magnitude of the shocks. So if, for example, oil prices go up again.
The board also adjusted the GDP projections to factor in the slowdown of domestic consumption. But the BSP emphasized the lower growth rate in the second quarter is not related to the bank's monetary tightening.
If you look at the Q2 GDP numbers, it was a surprise to everyone. Very striking is the contraction of government spending by about 7%. So to some extent, the base effects will be maybe present there, but also it highlights the need for different government agencies to ramp up their spending.
But at least one analyst believes the second quarter GDP growth may have influenced the decision of the BSP.
I believe it it played an integral part in the post today. Well, the BSP, when it makes a move, it's always trying to keep a balance between price stability and the health of the economy. Given that we are seeing a downtrend in our inflation right now, both headline and core, though they are still elevated, and at the same time, the BSP saw a weakness in the second quarter GDP growth rate. If we're just going to talk about the second quarter GDP alone, then the BSP might have lowered policy rates. But then again, we also have this inflation picture that we are dealing with.
The Philippine economy expanded by 4.3% in the second quarter, slower than the 6.4% in the first quarter. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
The Department of National Defense expressing concerns over the substitute bill on military and uniform personal pension system. That's been approved by the House of Representatives Ad Hoc Committee. Secretary Gilbert Teodoro says he is against the proposed mandatory contributions for military personnel, especially for those who have already completed at least 20 years of active service without a transition face. Teodoro insists military and uniform personnel's pensions entitlements, including a 100% automatic indexation, should remain unchanged, saying ensuring the non-diminution of their benefits is the least that the country can do to recognize their sacrifices. He stresses the substantial distinction of the Armed Forces of the Philippines from all other uniformed personnel, saying while uniforms and ranks are similar, there is no uniformity in terms of the nature of their duties and responsibilities. He also points out the AFP does not get additional financial support from local government units, unlike other services. The National Commission on Senior Citizens urges online platforms and merchants to honor the senior citizen discount. Commission Chairperson Attorney Franklin Quijano says a joint memorandum circular was signed last year by agencies including the Trade and Social Welfare Department, setting the provisions for online purchases. These include food purchases made on food delivery platforms like Grab and Foodpanda, and even online bookings for flights. Based on the law, Filipinos aged 60 and above are entitled to receive up to a 20% discount on certain goods and services and a VAT exemption. The Land Transportation Office's issuance of plastic driver's licenses hitting another snag. This after a Quezon City court issued a TRO ordering the agency to stop accepting plastic cards from its supplier, Banner Plastic Card Incorporated, for 20 days. The court says it found, among others, that the deficiency cited in the disqualification of another bidder, AllCard Inc., was taken at face value and never verified. The LTO says this is a temporary setback and it is confident it can defend the awarding to Banner Plastic Card. A hearing is scheduled next week, August 22. The agency, however, says if the court stops this deal, they are considering options such as extending the validity of expiring driver's licenses for 6 months. Now, earlier this year, the LTO was forced to issue paper-based driver's licenses due to a shortage in plastic cards. Now, Banner Plastic Card is supposed to deliver an initial 1 million cards by end of September, hitting the total 5.2 million cards by February of next year. Treasure trove of cash recovered from the vaults of a gaming hub that was recently raided in Pasay City. Authorities are considering money laundering charges against the hub's operators. Mike Navallo reports.
One after the other, authorities opened these vaults found in a recently raided Pogo hub in Pasay City. Personnel led by officials from the Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission, Department of Justice, National Bureau of Investigation, and the Anti-Money Laundering Council inspected the vaults on the basis of a search warrant issued by a Pasay City court. Authorities believe the vaults contain passports, visas, financial records, employment contracts, pre-registered SIM cards, and money derived from illegal operations from the POGO facility. The first vault yielded 3.2 million pesos in cash and one passport. The second one had almost 3 million pesos in cash, aside from money in other currencies. Authorities also recovered car keys, passports, cell phones, deposit slips, and sales vouchers. They also retrieved USBs, crypto wallets, and seed phrases or passwords used in cryptocurrency.
We're hoping, no, in the rest of the vaults, na may makita pang mga transaction documents, financial documents, para makita ho natin yung financial structure ng operations nila.
Authorities are studying if money laundering could have been committed. Money laundering involves hiding the source of money obtained from illegal sources and making them appear to have come from a legitimate source. An ABS-CBN source said the presence of crypto wallets at the POGO facility indicates inflow or outflow of money and could be an indication of money laundering.
If we see a pattern or a web of financial transactions in relation to the scam operations found here in Pasay, that money laundering charges will also be filed.
Aside from money, authorities also recovered a gun silencer, bullets, taser, and a handcuff.
These indicate na itong mga operators na ito ay involved din sa iba pang mga criminal activities. Meron tayong narinig dati mga reports na may mga kidnapping, no, amongst mga POGO operators. So this only proves to show na meron talaga tayong nakikitang criminal activities other than yung pag-scam.
Authorities raided the POGO hub on August 1st after they found out it was engaged in love scam and crypto scam. Complaints for violations of the Cybercrime Prevention Act and Securities Regulation Code have been filed with the Department of Justice. On August 7th, authorities presented an estimated more than 20,000 SIM cards which have been pre-registered even before they could be opened. They're now preparing a complaint for violation of the SIM Registration Act. Of the more than 600 POGO employees found in the POGO hub on August 1st, around 230 foreigners are still in the facility facing immigration procedures. Bagor has cancelled the license of the POGO hub due to unauthorized activities which also affected the visas of these foreigners. Meanwhile, more than 400 Filipinos were set free, with around 80 of them still being investigated by the DOJ over their alleged involvement in illegal activities in the POGO hub. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte will temporarily oversee the 14 schools caught in the middle of the territory dispute between the cities of Taguig and Makati. Robert Manyo reports.
Teachers of Benigno Ninoy Aquino High School welcome the decision of the Department of Education to temporarily supervise the 14 schools entangled in the decision of the Supreme Court over the Makati-Taguig territorial row. It's one less problem for teachers as the opening of classes nears.
Nakita ko doon na ang light of hope, sobrang nakakakaba na talaga yung mga pangyayari habang lumalapit ang pasukan.
Many parents are relieved as Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte announces a transition plan.
Sana po masuportahan po niya ng maayos ang pag-aaral ng mga bata na hindi sila maguluhan po.
The DepEd says Duterte's initiative is meant to ensure proper preparation and the smooth opening of classes.
We need transition plan kasi nga kailangan natin mapag-usapan yung mga detalye. Kung paano na yung utilities, for example, paano yung mga existing contracts, at paano siyempre yung paglipat ng ating mga teachers.
In a DepEd order, the transition committee will include a regional director assigned outside NCR, the division superintendent of Taguig, Pateros, and Makati, and the city legal officers of Makati and Taguig. During the transition, school activities including related programs from the local governments of Taguig and Makati must have the approval of the education secretary. The school heads will also report directly to the education secretary, while the PNP will ensure the implementation of the DepEd order. DepEd adds classes in the affected schools will commence on August 29, but if problems still arise, schools are advised to come up with a contingency plan.
Bigyan na po tayo ng instruction sa regional director na siguraduhin na meron tayong contingency plan at meron naman po mga learning continuity plan.
DepEd also explains there's no need for the secretary to intervene in the ownership issue of the schools since this is under the purview of the court. Makati Mayor Abby Binay welcomes the decision of the DepEd, adding they are looking forward to working with the transition team. Binay adds the development will greatly ease the worries and concerns of students, parents, and teachers. The local government of Taguig also thanked the vice president for her decision. Taguig says it is committed to the smooth, orderly, and peaceful transition. They also hope to receive the data they have been requesting from Makati to allow the local government to effectively extend assistance to those affected. Despite the conflict between the neighboring cities, teachers assured students they can still expect quality education when classes resume. Robert Mano, ABS-CBN News.